Thank you. Okay, so I'm Alicia Benoit. I'm from Jersey City, New Jersey. And this is the single image stereoscopic autopseudogram. This is something that a lot of people will maybe recognize from real life. It looks something like free viewing, and basically really is free viewing. And then there are photographs taken of, like, you know, my day-to-day life as I walk around and I free view it. So there are single photographs containing repetitive visual elements. They can be fused stereoscopically for free viewing, and free viewing, like, you know, it's a human function. It predicts photography, and it can be employed pretty much by anyone. These specifically are for cross viewing, but they can just as easily be free viewed and also be viewed via a viewer. And as far as I can tell, there is one example that everybody pulls up, which is an accidental type of stereo, which you can find in any image that's a photograph with any repetitive image in it. You could free view something in the image, but nobody has actually explored it beyond that point. And I looked around for a year and a half, and I asked a lot of, I've asked a couple of you guys, I asked everybody, I even asked Stereoscopic Society in England. Nobody's actually seen a portfolio of images that actually explore it beyond that point, so it might be the first one. And if anybody does know any, please let me know, because I'm very interested in it. So they could be free viewed either cross or parallel. And I'm saying cross viewing specifically for these, as you'll see, because parallel viewing is actually it predominates stereograms and single image stereograms, and those are all parallel views. So this is why I went pseudo with this, because these are all cross viewed, and there is nothing really addressing cross viewing. And so the goal of this is to place this type of stereoscopic image to be within the continuum of existing identified stereoscopic forms. And let me just make sure that it just, okay, cool. All right, so you have traditional stereoscopic images, which are, it's an object. You're taking two pictures of one object. That's two separate vantage points, and then you combine them in a way, either through a viewer, or however you do it, you're independently channeling the image to your left eye and your right eye, and you're forming a stereoscopic image in your head. Pseudoscopic images is just one picture of two or more things. And it's very, very simple like that. So it's one single viewpoint, one single image, and everything in the image itself is something that was repeated on the scene. It's either, like, you know, drawn, or it's like it's an object, or it's a piece of artwork, whatever. But either way, it's a photograph of the actual scene, and it's not something that was paired together afterwards. And so you use cross-eyed viewing because that's the only way that you actually channel the objects in the scene, that they actually become stereoscopic when you view them. And so the single image stereoscopic autopseudogram, since free viewing predates photography and it's a visual function which can be employed by anyone, you know, with a little effort and with a little know-how, so you could pretty much teach anybody. So this was, like, this was previously described by Wheatstone in 1844. It's essentially the basis of the wallpaper illusion, and this is very much the wallpaper illusion being photographed. This is, and which variations in a pattern creates stereoscopic pairs and stereopsis. And Brewster also explored this wallpaper effect, and he noticed that repeating patterns in the wallpaper could trick the brain into seeing that matching pairs would float above one another, and the same virtual object on a same virtual plane could be behind a wall, could be in front of the plane. And basically, this is the basis of audio stereograms and also single image audio stereograms. They're kind of synonymous with each other, like, you could interchange the words. This is the opposite, kind of what a autopseudogram would be, only in the sense that when you view those images, they have to be viewed in parallel. And that's really the crux of a lot of the argument over here. So this is something that you could find anywhere. Like, you know, you could find wallpaper effects. This is a very easy way to find them. If you like just Google Wes Anderson or accidentally Wes Anderson, you get a lot of repeating patterns. And so these are autostereograms. And to classify these as autopseudograms, I probably wouldn't, because they weren't made with the intent, and that also has a lot to do with it as well. Things that were accidental is that's to be said after the fact, and that's something that I really kind of am trying to figure out where that would belong. But something like this, I would still say that they are autostereograms, and stereograms, by definition, just include all type of stereoscopic imagery. And hold on. So these go into stereograms. There are two ways an autostereogram can be viewed, the wall-eyed way and the cross-eyed way, which is basically saying parallel and cross-eyed. That's just like a Wikipedia definition. But like all the stereograms that you really see out there are all either parallel viewed, and I haven't found one that was published yet in a book or really even online that wasn't a parallel viewed a stereogram, and also they're usually computer generated images. And so you need to be, you need to either have parallel viewing as a free viewing, as your free viewing method, or you can use a viewer also. And so wall-eyed viewing requires that the two eyes adopt a relatively parallel angle, while cross-eyed viewing requires a relatively convergent angle. And an image designed for wall-eyed viewing, this is saying parallel the whole time, if it's viewed correctly, will appear to pop out of the background. Well, the cross-eyed will instead appear to be, and if it was behind the background, and it may be difficult to bring entirely into focus. So this is just basically like playing on how pseudo and ortho, or how cross-eyed and parallel can really be interchanged with each other, and it kind of really confuses issues altogether. And so when you look up autostereogram, you really only ever get, I've never gotten another image that wasn't something like a magic eye, that wasn't a single image autostereogram. Even more so, like when you go into it, there's only any type of stereogram, you look up any type of autostereogram, but even, hold on, there should be another one, my bad. Oh, okay. And wait a second, that's not the one I wanted, excuse me. Okay, so when you look up even trying to look up like like anything pseudoscopic or anything cross-eyed, it even says cross-eyed stereogram, and that's already just like differentiating that all stereograms by nature are parallel viewed. And this mention, and it's all across the board, that this is specifically a cross-eyed stereogram, it's kind of just like negating a negative, and it should just be called a pseudogram in that case. Hold on, I don't know which one I did. Okay, so to define really what it actually means, I try to break it down. So a stereogram, of course, is any type of stereoscopic image. Single is one unit, of course. An image, and we're talking about image as in like a complex visual eye, something that's like a camera eye, not an eye spot that's just detecting light, because any animal that is using image-forming eyes always have two eyes or a pair of eyes. They're never an odd number, they're always an even number. And stereoscopic is meaning that there's a first-order discriminating function of the two visual inputs. And that's important to this because stereoscopic doesn't necessarily mean that by definition, if you look it up, it's saying that it's a correspondence of images that's formed in the brain. And I think it's more of a, basically it's not in the brain, excuse me, that it's in the retina, and that the visual images later form in the brain. And so that the stereoscopic action happens before the visual information actually gets processed. And auto means unassisted, and pseudogram is like, you know, I might as well be making up this word, but a pseudogram is saying that it's an unexplored stereogram because there is no definition for it yet. And so it's matching no other category right now, and that's why I want to make a category for it. And so, like, why do I even, like, preach pseudography? Because of holography. And holography is a place that you can see pseudoscopic and orthoscopic as they really are. They're really just a positive and a negative. They're really just an orthoscopic and a pseudoscopic of the same stereoscopic coin. And anything that it is it's an equal and opposite value of each side, no matter what side it is and no matter what the value is. The pseudoscopic version will always be the equal opposite of the orthoscopic version. And that just really illustrates it very well. Another place that you see ortho, and not really pseudo, but you actually see the word ortho being employed, is in AutoCAD. And that's basically like, you know, like the mode that you draw in. And it's just basically like referring to ortho as the real life situation. So pseudo would be kind of theoretical, I think, in AutoCAD. But the ortho mode is used when you want to specify an angle for distance, or by means of two points using a pointing device. Ortho mode, the cursor movement is constrained to the horizontal or vertical direction relative to the UCS, which is your user set parameters. And in a 3D view, the ortho is basically defined as being the Z also. So you either are a positive or a negative, but still on the same Z line. So the single image stereoscopic pseudogram, that's a general category as a whole. And I want to include that just because it can include other things that I didn't define and that can be categorized within it. But it separates it from the subclass, which is the one that I really explored, which is a pseudograph. And that's the photographs that I make. And this is an example of it. That's another example. So basically, I'm taking a photograph of two things. And they're able to be cross-viewed. And when they're cross-viewed, they're also able to be parallel. But for this, it looks more ortho when you cross them, I believe, in my sense. So this is why I'm... this is why I'm classifying that as the, I lost my train of thought for a second. But this is the basis of it, basically, is that it's just a single image that you're free viewing in real life, and you're just snapping a picture of. And I want to name it Pseudograph after two of my friends, Susan Pinsky and David Starkman. Because they're the most 3D people I know, and they really held the community together forever. And if I name a stereo after something, I want to name it after them. And it'll forever join their name in 3D. So these are two different types of this image. This is a pointed variety, and this is a composed variety, and I'm going to break them down in a second. There's two types of photographs that you could take with this, or pseudographs. This is a composed shot, and I literally just did this. I know wherever I go, there's always going to be two of some item, and that I can compose them on the spot anywhere I am, no matter what. So this is made out of breakfast today. And this is you just have to align them, and you can make them out of any two items. A pointed one is composed by you, but it is not necessarily... the composition is not necessarily created by you. So the shot is composed and framed, but the composition is not necessarily yours. That's the difference between those two. And these are just ones that like you could free view if you have the ability to, and I'm going to be doing them in 3D in a second. So these are just examples of the ones that you're going to be seeing. And these I had to chop in half and then do the left as the right and the right as the left. And so, because I don't know if everybody cross views. And that's a big hurdle for people who don't, because you're unable to really show somebody that unless I chop it up and I do it like this, or unless you give somebody a pseudoscope. And that's just a pain. So, and these are, just These are just superimpositions of the cross views. That one got smushed. Can everybody see that one? Is that a little too harsh? That's a little harsh? Okay. You can go really extreme with it also. And so that's the other thing also, is that there's a lot of disparity in them. Sometimes you could kind of block a scene out that you really don't get too much, but something like that, like, you know, if you're really, really sensitive to rivalry, like even just like the cracks in the lines will give you too much, let alone the actual, you know, the actual extremeness of that. But these so far, I haven't seen, and there's a lot of graffiti ones, because that's a very common tagging move to do, is your same exact tag over and over until you get it perfect. So that's something that you'll always find repeated. That's one, just in case you didn't like it the first time, there it is the second time. So this one I like to put because everybody emails me back, like, why are you sending me this blurry image? And I'm like, does it still stereo? And they're like, okay. And I'm like, that's the whole point. So it doesn't need to be actual visual information that makes sense. It just needs to stereo. And I had to stand here for a long time to get flags that actually blew in the same exact direction to capture them. And that's breakfast this morning. And like, no matter where you go, you'll always have two things. And it's been argued that like Wheatstone could have done it. And it's like, of course he could have done it. But like, you know, like there wasn't really like the Industrial Revolution back then. So he really didn't have just countless arrays of items of the same exact thing to just like play around with. And that's, I guess it says something about mass marketing consumerism against that as well. But no matter where you go, you're always gonna have two things. And if it's faster to block something out and take one picture, if it's less file space, there's a lot of reasons why you could do it. It's fun. So this is a type of stereo image that nobody's really been kind of pushing or kind of exploring. And although accidentals exist and they're fun to spot, you can make your own. And that's what that is.